Happy Christmas.
Happy Christmas.
It's great to be in God's house on Christmas Day, isn't it?
Yeah. Amen.
It's a lot warmer than I thought. When you come here, it's a 50-50 chance whether it's freezing or tepid. But it's actually boiling this morning. If you want us to, if it helps, we can open some of the windows.
Yes.
Would that help? Okay, we've got four open. We'll open some more now in a second. The interesting thing is the heating is underfloor heating. So, unless you can spread your bodies on the floor and keep away from it, we'll have a problem. Okay, it's great to see so many on this Christmas morning. It's great to be, as I said, in God's house.
Amen.
Let's just pray and then we've got a little bit of a program for you this morning. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you that this special day, your birthday, we've come to give you praise and give you thanks. Lord, we'd have nothing if it weren't for you coming. And Lord, we just thank you that you have come. You've come amongst us. And Lord, you've come and you've brought us life everlasting. Just be with us, Lord, as we pray this morning, as we worship this morning, as we come and give you thanks for all you mean to us and all that you've done for us. And Lord, we just want to tell you this morning that we love you. We love you for all that you are and all that you've done. For your name's sake. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We're going to start with the video.
Is this the real birth? Is it nativity? Caught in a census in the town of his ancestry. Open your eyes. Look up to the skies and see. He's just a poor boy, foretold by prophecy. Because the wise men go, angels high, shepherds low. This is how God's love shows. It's a wondrous story to me.
Come, wise men go, will Herod let him live? Right out of here.
is how God's love shows.
Slightly different. You'll have noticed the guitarist has been modelled on Jane's guitar playing, especially the banging of the head. So we'll have Jane now, and the rest of the group. So again, we've got a carol to sing, and I've forgotten what it is, so I'll go back. Oh, Holy Night. Now we're going to go with the words that come up on here. Okay, you might know different words. So do we. We'll try to go with the ones that are on there. Made a mistake. We're taking an offering this morning. This is for people who are not as well off as we are, people who may be alone this Christmas in the sense of their cap families. So if you've not come to give, that's fine, there's no problem. Just glad that you're with us. So the kids will come around and take the offering.
And the
next year we're going to get the song and the words to be the same. That's what we're going for. Thanks. Just going to pray for the offerings that we've received this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the offerings of your people, and we just ask that you would multiply it. And as we use it for people who are in difficult circumstances at this time, Lord, they will be blessed, and we will be blessed in you, for your name's sake.
Amen. Amen.
We're going to have a reading now. We're going to ask Noel to come and give us the first reading. We're only having Noel because it is Noel.
Isaiah chapter 9, beginning at the verse 2. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For unto us a child is born, yes, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this, and the Lord will bless his word to us. Amen.
Amen. Stand and sing Silent Night.
Holy.
have Jess with us this morning. And because she's coming, she has to work. So she's going to do the next reading for us.
So this reading is taken from Luke 1, verse 26. And it reads, "In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent an angel Gabriel to a town in Galilee named Nazareth. He had a message for a girl promised in marriage to a man named Joseph, who was a descendant of King David. The girl's name was Mary. The angel came to her and said, 'Peace be with you. The Lord is with you and has greatly blessed you.' Mary was deeply troubled by the angel's message, and she wondered what his words meant. The angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary. God has been gracious to you. You will become pregnant and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High God. The Lord God will make him a king, as his ancestor David was, and he will be the king of the descendants of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end.' Mary said to the angel, 'I am a virgin. How can this be?' The angel answered, 'The Holy Spirit will come on you, and God's power will rest upon you. For this reason, the Holy Child will be called the Son of God. Remember your relative Elizabeth. It is said that she cannot have children, but she herself is now 6 months pregnant, even though she is very old. For there is nothing that God cannot do.' 'I am the Lord's servant,' said Mary. 'May it happen to me as you have said.' And then the angel left her."
How could this happen? I'm just speechless. We were getting married. I thought God was with us. Every time she speaks, I guess she was from my bone. I feel so betrayed. I feel so alone. I don't believe it. I just can't. Because if it means what I think it does, she's broken my heart. And she won't stop with the half truths and the lies. Of course she's played away from home. Either that or she's putting away the pies. It breaks my heart. She's left me for another guy. But what makes it worse is her obsession to lie. I don't want your excuses. It's still deceit. At least give me the decency of admitting you're a cheat. She tells a story. Listen, Joe, an angel appeared. Is she taking a mick or just being weird? Joe, I'm with child, a boy, a son. You know there's an heir to David's throne, she says. Well, he's the one. So you're giving birth to God's chosen son. This bun in your oven then, he's the one, as in the one who will reign for all the time. Mary, have you had too much wine? Look, just save it, all right? You made your bed, so lie in it. Oh, hang on, you already did, and there was someone else there with you in it. And that's when I stormed off and made my exit. Why did she do this? I don't need this grief. I don't want a divorce, but it's the only course left for me. The wedding's off. She's had an affair. You don't believe me? The proof's right there. Then later that night, I had this dream. An angel turned up, said, "Mary's record's clean. Don't cancel the wedding. Don't freak out. It was through God's Holy Spirit this miracle came about." My heart skips a beat. I can't take this in. The angel says call him Jesus because he'll save people from their sin. So then I woke up and did what he said. And a bit later on, Mary and I wed. Some months later, Jesus arrived. There were wise men with gifts and shepherds at his side. And when I remember his humble birth, the penny drops of why he came to this earth. I don't believe it. I just can't. Because if it means what I think it does, he's God incarnate. The embodiment of God in skin and bone. My stepson will live amongst us, so we'll never be alone. And here's a point I need to tell. Jesus' name is also Emmanuel. That's good news you can trust, because his name means God is with us.
visit of the Magi. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the peoples, chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star that they had seen in the east went ahead of them until he stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route.
It's a special day today, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's a special day in God's calendar too. Because God planned all that happens at Christmas, all of it, he planned well in advance. It was with the day when Jesus became flesh, when he became skin and bones just like you and me. And he was sent on a mission, sent on an adventure. And that mission and adventure was to bring us back to God himself, because we'd gone so far from him. You see, it all started well in the Garden of Eden, where God walked with Adam and with Eve in the cool of the day, scripture says, and everything was fine and everything was well until sin came into their experiences and caused the good that was there to disappear. Can you imagine what it was like for God, who had previously looked at all that he had created and declared, not that it was good, he said it was very, very good. It was that good that it had to have two verys in there. He had made something so wonderful. And God sought to restore the world and the whole of mankind back unto him. And there had to be a plan. There always has to be a plan, doesn't there? Mm-hmm. And the plan that he had, the plan involved Jesus. It's not the plan that I would have chosen if I'd been God, Jesus' father. It's not the way that I would have considered. But we need to understand that our ways are not God's ways. And he does things in a wonderful and a new way. So Jesus came. We've had it, as Noel has read it this morning, where in Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7, there's a beautiful words there, where it says, "He is wonderful counselor, mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." What titles to have. I went to have some work done on my car the other day, and the guy there said, "And what's your title?" I must admit, I thought, me. And I said, "Just Paul Hammond." And he said, "Nothing else?" And I thought, right. So I said, "Well, you can put the Reverend if you want." And he said, "Yes, Reverend, we'll put that on there." He seemed to want a title. He seemed to want something quite special. But those are the titles that we hear of Jesus, the titles that God gave him. In Matthew chapter 1 and verse 21, it says, "And she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus. There's something wonderful about that name. Because why? Because he will save his people from their sins. In other words, he's the solution. The problem is there, but he is the solution to bring many sons and daughters back unto him. In the song we're going to sing in a little while, it says on there, Jesus has come this happy morning. And it is a happy morning. Yeah. When a birth comes, it's always a happy morning, isn't it? Mm. And that is a happy morning because Jesus came for us. Mm. I do like the fact that Jesus doesn't do things the way we think he should do them. And he doesn't operate in the manner in which we think is right. He has his own way and his own plan. And can I tell you something? It's always better than ours. Always so much better than the way we would do it. Their expectation as people would be that a mighty warrior would come to save Israel. That he would be born in a palace. He would be born in perhaps a temple. But no, this wasn't the time. And that was the only time, the once time, when our world, a stable, was something that was bigger than the whole of the world. Jesus was born in a stable, bigger than the whole of the world in that way. So in a way, to the people, the religious and the royalty of the time, they were expecting something different. The gift was not the gift that they had expected. Perhaps we could go a bit further and say the gift that came was not the gift they wanted, but it was the gift that would cause a solution to the problems they were in. He came to change the circumstances of people. It may have not been, as I've said, the way we thought, but he came to die, and his death brought a life that caused us to live beyond what we could ever have imagined. They had their own ideas, they had their own plans, but it was not that. Shepherds were there, wise men were there, stables were there. I'm sure they would have come up with something much better than all this. And to make matters worse, Herod was there, and he was out to destroy God's answer and God's solution and God's remedy for the way of this world. And in a real way, in a real reason, they were disappointed. They were really disappointed because they did not understand the gift that God was sending and how it worked and how it concerned their lives. I was saying last Sunday, it's a video, it's an Australian little lad who is an Australian angel. And when God the Father is saying to all of heaven, we need to solve this problem, he said, I'm going to send my son. And the response from this little lad is quite simply this: well, they won't be expecting that. And it's so true. They weren't expecting that way because God has his own way. Second book of Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 15 speaks about a gift. And it says this: thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. The Message puts it differently, and it says, meanwhile, moved by the extravagance of God in your lives, they will respond by praying for you in passionate intercession for whatever you need. Thank God his gift, no language can praise it enough. And that's the gift that God has come and given you in his Son. The Amplified Bible goes on to say this: now thanks be to God for his gift, precious beyond telling. His indescribable, inexpressible, free gift — notice it's a free gift — is for you and for me. This gift is totally free, yet it cost Jesus everything because he came and he died for each and every one of us. Do you know what the most desired gifts are for this Christmas? There's things I don't know anything about, I'll tell you. Squishmallow toys. Anybody know what squishmallow toys are? What are they?
There's some squishy thingies.
Squashy thingies.
Oh, no.
Oh, right. See, Welsh catcher. Oh, right. I won't tell you how much these cost. Squishmallow, apparently these are the thing. if you haven't got one of these, I'm going to get upside down. That shows you how much I know about this. But that's one of the things. So I'll put that down there. The other one is the story, the boy, the mole, the fox, the horse, and the animated story. Now I've got that book, so I know about that one. This is one for Paul Archer. The other one that's very expensive, actually, £90. It's I'm a Stylist Head. So you can have it all coiffured and done. So that could be for next year, Jane, if you haven't got anything for this year. Another one was Lego Creator Expert. Santa's Visit. Again, lots of money. This one I don't understand. Play-Doh ice cream cart. Anybody got one of them? Play-Doh ice cream cart? £150. I'll leave it there. The only one I did understand was VTech JotBot, which is a robot. And that is what the in thing is for this Christmas, so I'm told. But how long will these things last for? And how long before the batteries run out? Or the batteries run down? I remember one year, many, many years ago, my mother and father decided they were going to buy us certain presents. But not thinking about it fully, they were all battery driven. Guess what we didn't have on Christmas Day? No batteries at all. And of course, it's not even like it is these days where you possibly call in somewhere and get some. We had to sit there going, this is nice, isn't it? And when it works, it'll be even better. But you see, it was reliant upon something else. People have spent hundreds of pounds. People have spent thousands of pounds. But they're really of no great value. Because at some stage, you will either outgrow them or that you will, they'll have run out of their course for you. I saw a photograph of myself the other day. And I'm there with a black mask on. And a rapier sword. So who was I?
Darth Vader.
Zorro. Thank you. See, I'm a little bit older than you may think. But that's Zorro. So, you know, I haven't still got that, I have to say. However, have any of you heard of Davy Crockett?
Yes.
Well, I have got a Davy Crockett coat. I should have worn it, and I forgot to bring it. However, I might have got my fingertips in it, because it's slightly different size to what I was when I bought it. Oh, it was bought for me. But what I'm trying to say this morning is, you see, all these gifts are the gifts that people got. Oh, I need one of them. I must have one of those. I must have that. But the greatest gift to ever have is God's gift to you. It's beyond price. It's beyond cost. And he has given it to us freely because he loves us in that way. So a little saying the other day, it says, 1,000 times in history, a baby has become a king. That's true. But only once in history did a king become a baby. That's wonderful, isn't it?
Yes.
Many have been called kings because of their birth, but he became a baby in order that he could bring you life. But God became flesh, scripture says, dwelling amongst us as a gift that is indescribable. It's indescribable, incomparable. It's something that money can't ever buy, but something more important. And you know something about it? It's a personal gift. It's yours. I have a cousin and well, more than one, but I have a cousin in particular I'm thinking of. They came to see us on Christmas Eve, and my mother hadn't bought anything for him because we didn't know they were coming and they didn't normally buy. So all of a sudden, a book came out that was given to him, which I found out the next day was mine. My gift, my book, and he walked away with it. Now, I reminded him of this some 20 years later and said, have you still got my book? Are you looking after it? But you see, the good thing about God's gift is it's for you. He isn't giving it to anybody else. He's giving it to you because you are that important to him. You see, Jesus, when he came, he took on our limitations. He became exactly like we are. And he lived in a world and he identified with the sufferings of people in that world. The same voice that spoke creatively and creative words became a vulnerable little baby. Why? Because he loves you. Because he wants you to be with him. People often say when they look at their circumstances, yeah, but you don't know what I'm going through. You don't know what it's like for me. You haven't lived my life and my experience. You can never say that to Jesus, because he lived life in the same way as you and I do. And he saw it all and he experienced it all. And he went further than that. He died for all, for you and for me. You remember when he was born, the brightness of the star. And he wants us to know today the brightness and the light of his experience in each of our experiences too. And take the darkness of this world away. He's the greatest Christmas gift that can be. He is the true Christmas gift for you and I this Christmas. Have you ever had a Christmas gift and you've looked at it and you thought, oh, yeah. I can remember my mother bought me something and one of my brothers had suggested that this is what I would definitely want. And I looked at it, and you know you have to keep that face that goes, yes, Well, you know, your brother said you'd love that, and you go, yes, I'll get him later. And it's not a gift that it's actually a model thing, and it's away now, and it's not likely to come back out. Because when I looked at it, it's not what I wanted. But yet God says when he gives, it's pressed down, shaken together, running over, it meets your needs. And when you look at it and see it, you go, that's just what I wanted. That's just what I needed, because that's what he does. You see, God is a gracious giver. He's also a disproportionate giver. He gives you more than you ever give him. And he gives it in that wonderful way. It's all freely given to you and to me. Jesus gave his all, his all, for you, your life and for mine. A gift that is unspeakable. I read something and I've written it down. It says on there, Jesus' gift was outrageous. Isn't that wonderful? It was outrageous. Beyond what you could think, beyond what you would understand, beyond what you could compare or even think. But he gives to you outrageously. And can I tell you this morning, if you don't know him, he has given to you outrageously. That's all he wants you to do, is to take what he's given you. If you remember, I think it was last Easter, little Ethan, we were, I might have got it wrong, it might not be Easter, but it still works. You had to open what we got for the kids, and it was an Easter egg, so it was Easter. And he came out, and he came out with Andrea, and you'd think he'd just pick it up and say thank you, and off he'd go. He demolished it in about half a second. He was into it, ripping it. He wanted what was inside. For him, that gift had to be opened. That gift had to be possessed. Can I say, tell you, that's what the same thing is with God. He doesn't want you to look at it and say, like these candles, oh, they're pretty, aren't they? They're totally ineffective if they don't work. And what he wants you to do is he wants you to see what he's done for you. And he's brought you that greatest gift that anyone could into your heart and into your life. Gifts produce from God a new heart, a new life, a new outlook, a new perspective, a new and a wonderful future. What's before you this morning? God can fulfill those things concerning you, and he can bless you in a wonderful way. He loves us all. He loves us, and he loves us with life, not just for time, but for eternity. He's a gift that never stops giving. Never stops giving. He gives, and he gives, and he gives again. He's the hope for the hopeless. He's strength to those who are weak. He's food to those who are hungry, and there are people in that position today. He's water to those who are thirsty. He loves the unlovely. He encourages the discouraged, and he lifts up the fallen. And the best gift that you can have today, I don't know if you've opened your gifts already and you think, oh, that's great, or whatever, but whatever you've got today is nowhere near how great the gift is that Jesus has for you. So you need to know him. You need to have an experience with him. He has shown his love for you. And that's all he wants, is for you to love him back and for you to give him that love and that joy. So your gift today is beyond measure, beyond money, beyond cost, beyond everything. It's Jesus' love for you. And I pray today that you know that experience, that you are known of him and give him your all. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to sing our final carol. I'm going to ask you to sit for this, because when you're all standing, nobody can see the screen. So we're going to sit and sing, "Oh Come, O Ye Faithful." Just want to thank you that you have come, not that you will be coming, because there are many who are looking for you to come, but you've already come, and you've come and you've brought life and love into each of our experiences. Lord, we just pray today that each one of us will experience that life, that love, and know you as Lord and as Savior. So thank you, Lord, for all you've done. Thank you, Lord, for what you mean to us. And as we leave this place, Lord, cause us to be ever thinking about what this really means, about what this time of Christmas really means, when you came for each and every one of us. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you all for coming this morning. It's been great to see you all. The next meeting here will be in the main hall. Will be on the 1st of September. The 1st of September.
No way.
1st of January. Could be the 1st of September. 1st of January. Now I'm stuck already because I can't remember if it's 10 or 10:30.
10:30.
At 10:30. I knew that really. I'm just playing to the crowd. So at 10:30, if you can come along, that'd be really great. And we're going to have a time where we're going to share what we did for 2022. There'll also be some food. So that's a really good reason for coming. But it'd be lovely to see you all. Have a great day. Don't eat too much. Don't drink too much. But enjoy being blessed by God.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.